Welcome back into the GSMC Sports Podcast. We just finished up talking about the Lakers-Pelicans play-in tournament game that took place last night. That was the real thriller of the night because we saw on the later slate, the Sacramento Kings really hand it to the Warriors and end up with the win there to end the Warriors' season. They take away the win 118-94. And this was possibly an end of an era here in Golden State. We will get into those questions. But as for this game itself, this was a little bit of a weird one because it felt like the Warriors just never really had their game. And yet, despite that, they were down by just 4 points at halftime. And it seemed like there was a real chance that they could get themselves going. Steph Curry only had 5 points at half, and that is because of Keon Ellis, who had a phenomenal game last night. And we talked about this sort of leading into the playoffs. He has done such a tremendous job to fill in for specifically Malik Monk in some of those minutes, who was the sixth man of the year in my eyes. He goes down with an injury at the end of March. And Keon Ellis has found his way into the starting lineup. You would think that these are probably minutes that if you are the Kings GM, you probably wish Davion Mitchell was giving that level of production after selecting him in the lottery a couple years ago. But no, it's the undrafted Keon Ellis who his energy and what he provides for the Kings team here was just so impressive. There were some funny minutes with him towards the end of the game when this was just about locked up, when you saw Mike Brown really getting on Ellis. And that's the thing, is it was because Ellis was clearly tired. He was laboring a little bit after chasing around Steph Curry all night long. And Mike Brown, who of course used to work on the Warriors staff, was very clear, you can't let up yet, the game's not over, we can't let Steph Curry get hot, which is very fair. But Keon Ellis, again, the game that he had he deserves tons of credit, where he had 3 steals and 3 blocks. This is of course from a guard position, and his energy was just incredibly impactful. And, you know, I mentioned Davion Mitchell. The Kings probably wish that Davion Mitchell was a little more on the level of Keon Ellis, but he was also making some impactful spark plug plays as well. Knocked down at least 1 big 3 there, even though he did struggle from the field in this game. But really, like I said, the Kings got out to this hot start thanks to Keegan Murray, who scored 14 points in the first quarter. Keegan Murray, one of my favorite players in the league, and they sort of rode that through the first half as a whole, where really the second quarter, I mean, in a lot of stretches here, this was a pretty ugly game. Like I said, the Warriors never really had it all together, but it's not like the Kings put the pressure on Golden State until the third quarter, where it was De'Aaron Fox sort of getting himself going in this one. He had at least 14 points in the quarter, and that's when the Kings really started rolling. DeMontis Sabonis was also incredible in this game. Now, he was dealing with some foul trouble that limited him to a certain degree, but again, this is a little bit of a flipping the script situation here, where last year Sabonis was sort of, I wouldn't quite say exposed, especially considering he was dealing with an injury during the Kings series against the Warriors last year in the playoffs. But after putting together this tremendous season, it was almost downplayed as a result of, frankly, Draymond Green sort of was just the alpha in that matchup in particular. And again, Sabonis was not 100%, so that's not totally fair to say, but it was a massive reason as to why the Warriors were able to come out of that one. And also just the fact that Warriors had nobody else really going for them other than Steph Curry, who, again, he had 5 points in the first half. He had only taken 5 shots, one of them being a half-court heave to end off the first half, so he wasn't really looking to be quite as aggressive. He got himself going in the second half a little bit more, was more assertive, taking 11 shots in the second half, scoring 17 points, but he was just doing it on his own, and by the end of the game, the Kings were literally throwing 2-3 defenders at Steph every single possession, and nobody else could make it count for the Warriors in this situation. Jonathan Kuminga provided some, especially earlier on in the game. He gave some good minutes attacking, got himself going, especially in the second quarter. I also, Moses Moody, I just can't quit him. He wasn't necessarily a game changer in this game, but I thought that he was probably a top three best player on Golden State last night to at least some degree. I know he only played 15 minutes, but he was incredibly efficient. He was getting to the free throw line when he was, and playing some solid defense as well. But for the Warriors here, I mean, you have to look at the fact that Klay Thompson, there's been so much conversation surrounding him this season. He ends up going 0-for-10 from the field and was just a completely dejected look on his face after he missed that final three-pointer. Seemed like he was just questioning everything, which, again, I know that a lot of people dislike the Warriors because of the dynasty that they've been for the past, you know, almost decade, but it is legitimately sad to see sort of Klay Thompson in this type of a funk where he is one of the best three-point shooters of all time. And going to be very interesting to see what happens with him in the offseason. Steve Kerr made it adamant that he wants Klay Thompson to be back, that they're all in on having him remain around. Big question is going to be what the contract situation looks like, because the Warriors were the most expensive team in the NBA this season in that second threshold for the luxury tax, and yet they were the 10 seed in the regular season and have failed to make the playoffs. Unfortunately, they've failed to make the playoffs in a handful of these recent years, despite also winning a final. So it's not like it's been this incredibly disappointing run for them, and they even made the second round last year, but they're going to have loads of questions surrounding them. I don't think that it's completely over for them necessarily. You still have Steph Curry, who, again, I don't think you can have watched that game last night and blame him for the reason the Warriors lost that game. They still have him at, I wouldn't quite say the peak of his powers. He's not the MVP level that he was in the 2010s, but he's still an incredible player. And they got the contributions from some of their young players this season in Jonathan Kuminga, Brandon Pajemski, Trayce Jackson-Davis, who didn't play very much last night. It just seemed like it was sort of a bad matchup to have him. He ended up starting the game but only played 11 minutes because they had Draymond guarding Domantas Sabonis, and as a result, Jackson-Davis was playing more on the perimeter. I believe he was initially matched up against Harrison Barnes, and it just really didn't add up there. Jackson Davis very possibly could be on an all-rookie team as well, but that was not the position you wanted him in necessarily. But sort of on the conversation of the big man position, I thought that one of the key statistics from the game, and I guess the discrepancy isn't even totally outstanding in terms of total rebounds, but the rebounding battle from last year in the playoffs to this year, where Kevon Looney was putting on an absolute clinic in terms of operating the glass to the way that it was the Kings this time around, 49 rebounds to 42, but specifically 15 to 8 in the offensive rebound department. The Kings getting themselves second chance opportunities, and that's, I think, in large part sort of what led to the Warriors just not having their heart in it It was early in the fourth quarter, even. There was an instance where Draymond Green chased an uncontested rebound too far out of bounds, stepped on the sideline, and it resulted in a turnover. It was the Warriors' third turnover in the first 4 minutes of the fourth quarter, and from that point, it just seemed like they were checked out. And this is a Warriors team that in the past has never, you know, gotten too down on themselves when the odds were against them, but it didn't seem like they had that same mental makeup this year. And again, going to be interesting to see how they retool, because I wouldn't say, you know, they need to make changes. I wouldn't say it's an entire blow it up, start the rebuild situation, because you have Steph Curry still at the level of play that he's giving you, but gonna need to find a way to cut costs. We've talked about this on the show for a handful of months now. The Andrew Wiggins contract is a massive negative for them. And, you know, last night definitely was not his best game. I wouldn't say that he was necessarily their worst issue. I mean, he was still providing some defense for them. The shot wasn't there, and everything just looked disjointed for the Warriors last night. Both teams, I want to look right now at the turnover numbers, because the Warriors had 16, and Kings had 8 as well. I'm actually surprised that that's as low as it was, but they did play a much cleaner second half. But this was just, you know, a very interesting game here, where you have the sort of subplot of the Kings, the Kings coming back into, well, they were home court advantage, and sort of leads to why this was so momentous. And I think it was a huge advantage that they had the home court behind them, but this felt like it had a little bit of extra baggage behind it from a historical standpoint. And they come out, win this game. And for the Kings, they are advancing to play the New Orleans Pelicans in a game to potentially seal a playoff berth. The winner of that game tomorrow night will advance to play the Oklahoma City Thunder, who are a very talented team, are in no means, though, an ungettable team. I do think that the Thunder probably come out on top in a series against either one of those opponents, especially if Zion is not going to be playing for them. He's supposed to be reevaluated in a couple weeks, which does not make it sound like he is going to be available, even if the Pelicans do advance here. But, you know, for the Kings to overcome the adversity, last year was sort of the perfect situation for them, where they had a lot of health, they had a lot of things going for them, they were this fun up-and-coming team. But this year, losing Malik Monk, who was incredibly important for them, losing Kevin Huerter, and still being able to overcome this type of adversity and end up knocking off, probably from a Kings perspective, if there are any Kings fans out there that have different input, probably their biggest rival in the NBA. So credit to the Kings there. I'm sure we're going to be talking plenty about the Warriors as the offseason nears closer. But on that note, we are going to be taking our second break. And when we come back on the other side, we're going to be diving into the news about Jonte Porter receiving a lifetime ban from the NBA. So stick with us, and we will be right back.